If you have Bibles, and we always encourage you to bring your Bibles here at Calvary, turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3. And how many like the book of Corinthians? Have you ever said it? I mean, it's such a good book. I tell you, Kevin spoke, did a great job. Amen. Give it up for Kevin. Kevin did a good job. But this week, we already did one start teaching in Corinthians, and we found out that the Corinthian church, you remember, was a church that moved in the gifts, moved powerful in the gifts, but yet was very immoral. As we're going to see when we get to chapter 5, that it says that a man was sleeping with his father's wife, and so pretty bad stuff. But yet, they asked Paul about marriage, and he spends the first six chapters talking about the things they need to correct. And so how many know that's kind of apropos, maybe not the mother thing, but how many know the Church of Jesus Christ is pretty immoral? Amen? Can we say that sadly? Amen means it's true, right? And we need to bring that back. Amen? How many want to do that? Bring back honor to the church. And so we need to do that. But the title of today's message is Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace. And I want to tell you a story that I thought was pretty good about grace. And here it is. In a small rural community, so small in fact that only church in town was a small Baptist church, whose pastor had to double up as a local barber to make ends meet. There happened to be a man in the small town in the community who had invested wisely and was enjoying his newfound wealth and comfort. This man got out of bed one day to go through his daily routine. He looked into the mirror and was about to shave and decided, you know, I make enough money now. I don't have to shave myself. I'll go down to the barber and let him shave me from now on. So he did. He walked into the barber shop and found the preacher/barber was out visiting some people in the hospital. His wife, Grace, however, said, I usually do the shaves anyway, so sit down and I'll shave you. So he did. She shaved him, and he asked, how much do I owe you? $25, Grace replied. He said, man, I thought that's a pretty expensive shave. He said, I might have to get a shave every other day because it's so expensive. Nonetheless, he paid Grace and went on his way. The next day, he woke up, found his face just as smooth as the day before. No need to shave today. He thought, well, it was an expensive $25 shave. The next day, he awoke and found his face as smooth as the day before. He said, wow, he thought, this is amazing. He normally would need to shave every day to keep a good appearance. Day 3, he woke up and his face was still as smooth as the minute after Grace had finished shaving him. Now somewhat perplexed, the man went down to the barber shop, asked some questions. This particular day, the pastor was in, and the man asked him why his face was as smooth as it was the first day he was shaven. The kind old pastor gently replied, friend, you were shaved by grace, and once shaved, always shaved. Dwayne, I thought you liked that. Oh, there you go. It's a long joke, but hey, there you go. I'm ahead of Kevin, though, right? All right, good. All right, there we go. Anyway, let's pray and ask the Lord to just to continue to minister to us. Father, thank you so much for this day, and thank you for your goodness. We ask that we would learn from the Corinthian church. We'd learn the positives of that church, but we'd also learn the pitfalls of that church and say, God, we don't want to be that church. So help us, Lord. Help us to be men and women of integrity. That we thank you that you've robed us with your robes of righteousness. You've imputed righteousness to us just as if we'd never sinned. But Lord, you also say in Romans 13 that we are to clothe ourselves or to put on Christ, that we're to walk out righteousness. We're not just to be positionally right with you through your blood, but now we're to live a right, righteous life. Not to earn love, not to earn favor, but because we have love, because we are favored. And so all we can do is give you our lives in return. All we can say is, Lord, I want to honor you with my life. I want to honor you with my body. So Father, bless us, Lord. Let us learn. And let us, as James said, let us not be just hearers of these truths, but let us be effectual doers. Let us be people who put these truths into practice to where our lives really do honor you. We bring honor to your name, Lord. Father, your name is not real honored in America any longer, but Lord, we want to bring that honor back to your church. You're honorable, but Lord, let your church walk like you. So Father, bless us. We thank you and we commit this day to you in this teaching time. In Jesus' mighty name, everyone said,
amen. Amen.
Verse 3, grace to you and peace from God our Father and Lord Jesus Christ. Charis, which is the Greek word for grace, grace was a typical Greek greeting. Grace, unmerited, undeserved favor. Grace to you, grace. Shalom, or peace, was the Jewish or Hebrew greeting. That's what they would say. They would say shalom, or peace, which is the Hebrew counterpart. Here in Paul's other letters, he marries the two ideas. Always putting here this grace first, because a person cannot have true and lasting peace unless he understands and knows the amazing grace of God. Amen? Unless you have God's, and this is grace, I love this definition, unmerited, undeserved, unearned favor. How many like that? You didn't do anything to deserve his favor, his love, his mercy. That's grace, unmerited, undeserved, unearned favor. But once you have that, then what happens? Then you have peace because you know you're right with God. And we want to have that, amen? I love Romans 5:1 says this, therefore being justified by faith, there it is, that's grace, faith, putting your faith in Christ, him imputing his righteousness or grace to you, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. When you know the grace of God, when you know you're justified by faith in Christ, then you have peace. So peace, grace and peace are two great words, and we should maybe bring that back. We should say, hey, grace or shalom, right? We should say that to people. I heard another thing that was neat, and Kevin will check up on me and find out it's not true, but hear this. One commentator said this. It was neat. I don't know if anyone's ever heard this before, but have you ever wondered where we get the word high? High? You know, when you see someone high? Well, one commentator was saying this. I couldn't Google it, you know, and everything on Google is true, right? But I couldn't confirm it, but they say high. The Puritans used to say high, and high meant heaven's high, so live right. Heaven's high. High. Heaven's high. And then they used to say, hello, hell is low. Hello, so live right. Be careful, hell is low. How many know that's pretty cool if that's true? Amen. High, heaven's high, live right. Hello, hell is low. Be careful. Pretty cool. I mean, isn't that neat if that's where the origin came from? Again, I couldn't confirm it. So if you, you know, just, you know, check it out and prove me wrong. But it wasn't me. It was a commentator. So it might be, I can't guarantee it. But I thought that was interesting anyway, if that's true. Verse 4, I thank my God always concerning you for the grace of God, which was given to you by Christ Jesus. Paul couldn't say, I thank my God for your righteousness. Because the Corinthians weren't very righteous, amen? Amen? Sexual morality, they said, so bad that even the pagans don't do it. He couldn't say, I thank my God for your faith, because what? The Corinthian church wasn't very faithful. But he could, however, say, I thank my God for his grace given on your behalf. Because the Corinthian church needed grace, amen? Does anyone out there need grace? I need grace, amen, unmerited, undeserved favor, because I'll tell you this, guys, no matter how well you're doing, you know, we compare ourselves with others, and yet it says in 1 Corinthians 15 that those who compare themselves with others are foolish, but yet we do that. How we know to a holy God, all we have to do is sin once to blow it. James says you fail in one area of the law, you fail in all the law. So we can't say, hey, we're all good, amen? How many agree with me? We don't pray enough, amen? Does anyone want to be honest? We don't read enough. And then this is the big one, we definitely don't obey enough. Amen? The Bible says what a man knows to do and does not do it, it's sin to that man. And how many can say, I'm indicted by the things I know? If I lived half of what I know, I'd be a mighty man of God. Amen? So we need grace, unmerited, undeserved, unearned favor. And Paul realizes the seriousness of this situation. I kind of picture Paul as he's writing this with like a kind of a smirk on his face, a smiling smirk on his face, saying, when I think about you, I thank God for his grace. And how many know I can look at some of you and some of you look at me and say, hey, I thank God for his grace for you. Okay? Right? The way I preach sometimes. Sometimes I say things, I get in trouble, right? Some of you go, oh my goodness, I see you cringe. Right? But there's grace. Amen? Now, I'm a big one to say this. How many know we shouldn't use grace as a doormat for willful sin? How many know that? And there's a difference between, hear this, I want to say this real quick. Grace was not meant for a doormat for our willful sin. Amen? It wasn't that we can get saved and then keep sinning. It was that now we're saved and we've been given mercy and love and grace, unmerited, undeserved, unearned favor from God. But now when we're trying to live like Christ, how many know that's a really small target? And that if you remember what sin is, it's missing the mark. It's missing the bullseye. So when you're trying to be like Christ, you're going to miss it at times. That's what grace is for, amen? It's not for to willfully blow it. I love one person I heard say it this way. If someone is playing football at the U of A, and the coach says, Rodriguez says to one of the receivers, are you going to catch the ball? And he says, probably not. How many know Rodriguez is not going to be very happy? But if he says, you're going to catch the ball, he says, I'm going to do my very best. And if he does his very best but still misses the ball, how many know there's grace? We need to be trying to catch the ball for Jesus, living for Christ. But how many know sometimes you're going to miss the pass even though you really want to catch it? Does that make sense? So the difference between just letting the ball drop all the time, which a lot of people do. And Paul says what in Romans 6:1? He would say to the American church, should we sin that grace might abound? And he says, by no means. Grace was never meant for willful sin. It was meant when you're trying to live for God and you sincerely fall short. Amen? Verse 5, that you were enriched in everything by him in all utterance, all knowledge. Utterance and knowledge here is a reference to charisma or charismata, the grace giftings. Isn't that cool? That means the gifts of the Spirit, right? Some people get afraid of charismatic. How many know we're a charismatic church? We may not go, ooh, ooh, much, but we are a charismatic. You can laugh at that. We are a charismatic church, but we're kind of honkies. We kind of are a little stiff. But how many know we should move in the gifts more free? Amen. Come on, talk to me. Come on. Right? It's funny, when I have Pastor Jamie here, Black Pastor, you guys are like, amen, glory, hallelujah. With me, it's like, de-honkify, okay? But we need to be free in the Spirit. I mean, not crazy, because the Bible says where the Spirit of God is, there's liberty. There's a freedom, not a freedom to go crazy, but a freedom to walk in the fullness of God. And that's what I pray for us. We want that. But this charisma or charismata means grace giftings. It means you're gifted by the Holy Spirit because of his grace to walk in a spiritual gift. How many know we all have at least one spiritual gift? And a lot of us, do you know the Bible says that you and I, it says in 1 Corinthians 14:1, it says that we should first pursue love. How many know that's the greatest gift? Then second, we should pursue the gifts. We should earnestly desire the gifts, especially to prophesy. Now I want to ask you, without you raising your hand, how many of you have prayed lately, Lord, let me prophesy? Some of you go, even if I had a prophetic word, I wouldn't get up here and say it. But how many know you should want that? Why? Why does Paul say that? He says, because a prophetic word, which is what? Edification, exhortation, and comfort. It encourages the body of Christ. We should want that. We should want, and maybe you don't have to do it publicly or up front, but you should do it to each other. You should be able to give a word. When someone's discouraged, say, Lord, what would you say to them right now? And how many know it's not going to be a new revelation, but something of what God, some scripture, something that would encourage, exhort, and comfort somebody. And how many know we need that? Sometimes we're in worship service and we're just like, and sometimes it's a prophetic word that wakes you up to go, God is, what does it say? It says when there's a prophetic word that people will say, surely God is in your midst. Why? Because their heart was revealed. They're going, that's exactly what I was feeling. And God spoke to me. God's real. Oh my goodness, this is amazing. God is actually in his church. And we need that again. We need to have words of knowledge. Words of knowledge is where you know something you couldn't know. I tell you, it's amazing. I could tell you stories, but I won't because I'm trying to be on time now. But hear this. There's stories of where you just know stuff that people go, how did you know that? The Lord. And words of wisdom. How many know this? With this economy, your job. Some of you are trying to get a new job. Some of you are going, should I go back to school? What? How many know God's Spirit can give you the gift of wisdom? Anybody need wisdom out there? So you should cry out for it. But here's what James says. You have not because you what? Ask not. But yet you're commanded in 1 Corinthians 14:1 to pursue love, first gift, second gift, prophecy, and ask for whatever gift God has for you. Because the gift is not for you to toot your horn, but it's for you to build up the body of Christ. Amen? And we need to pray for that. We need to cry out. So that's what this is. It says every utterance of knowledge is the charisma or charismata, the grace gifts. That means it comes without. You didn't earn it. And it means the gifts of the Spirit. And you can read that in, Romans 12 and 1 Corinthians 12 and 14. Verse 6, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you. Verse 7, so that you may come short in no gift. They came short in no spiritual gift. That's what that's saying. Eagerly waiting for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ. When Paul looked at the Corinthian church, he could say, these people proclaim Jesus. These people know about Jesus. They're moving in the gifts of Christ, the spiritual gifts. They're excited about the return of Jesus. And hear this, whatever problems they had, these are some pretty impressive strong points. Amen? How many can say, honestly, that we might say, well, hey, we're not as bad as they are, maybe sexually, but yet, how many know we could say, but we're not as strong as they are in the gifts? Did you hear that? It says, they came short in no spiritual gifts. That means they had every spiritual gift exercised. Gifts of healing, gifts of miracles, gifts of words of knowledge, all those gifts. How many know we could use that again in the church? We could, because I was reading in Acts, I can't remember exactly where it was, but they said, I think it was in 4 when I read to you last week, it says, confirm your word, Lord, with signs and wonders following. Confirm it. How many know the word of God needs to be confirmed? Because some people say, okay, well, why is your religion any different than Buddhist or Muslim? Because why? There's power. Amen? There's power. You remember the blind man, what he said to the Pharisees when they said, why are you talking about Jesus? And he said, all I know is once I was blind, but now I can see. Do you want to be his disciple also? Because why? You can't argue with a man who's been blind all his life and now sees. He's like, hey, I'm changed by Jesus. I don't care what you say about him. He's good. Amen. And how many know, if you lay hands on people in the name of Jesus and they get touched and get healed, how many know that's going to kind of change their view of Jesus? And how many know the world ain't seeing a whole lot of good things about Jesus, or at least America is not saying a whole lot of good things about Christians or Jesus? Can even this much, as I said, be said about many churches today? You know, we may pride ourselves on not having the problems of the Corinthian church, but do we have their positives? Do we have their positives? And again, I encourage you, 1 Corinthians 14:1, pursue love. How many know that's the first thing we should want, to love each other? And how many know, a lot of churches, I think mega churches are so popular today? Because you can come in and out. It's like In-N-Out Burger. That's right. You can come in, slam, bam. You can kind of in and out. Don't have to talk to anyone. How many know our church, you got to love? You got it, because people are like, hey, where you been? I haven't seen you. Oh, my goodness. You know, big church, you can go, yeah, I've gone to, what service you go to? 11? Oh, I go to the 9 o'clock, right? What? You don't get caught here. Here you get caught. This is family. We know. Hey, where you been? Right? And you see people, you can tell people that are used to a big church when they come, I'm at the door shaking hands and they're like, I mean, they just want to get past me because they don't want to say hi to me because they're like, we ain't coming back, okay? Bye. You know. I'm freaking out the new people. Is there another exit so I don't have to see this guy? No. The grace of God was shown to the church in Corinth in that they lacked no spiritual gift. Now, this tells me something in us, hopefully very important, that the flow of the spiritual gifts in either a man or woman individually or in a congregation corporately is not an indication of true Christian maturity or holiness. Amen? It's an indication of God's amazing grace. Now, I don't know about you, but my humanness says, wait a second. If I pray and I'm more holy, I should have more gifts than someone who's not. But I want to tell you, this is what's so weird, and I'm just going to say this, and maybe I shouldn't, but some of the people I've seen move in spiritual gifts are some of the most ungodly people I've ever known. Amen? Amen. Right? I'll give you an example. Freak you out here. Calvary Chapel movement was started by this guy, Lonnie Frisbee. Anyone heard of Lonnie Frisbee? He was the hippie preacher. And Lonnie Frisbee also helped start the Vineyard, two major movements. And this guy was a little hippie guy. I mean, he's seriously skinny little dude, long beard, long hair. And he'd go, hey, come to Jesus, dudes. And people would come by the thousands. Greg Laurie, heard of Greg Laurie, the big evangelist? He was led to Christ by Greg Laurie, led him to Christ. Mike McIntosh, the other Calvary guy, led to Christ by him. Greg Laurie said, he's the big evangelist now, he said he'd go on the beach, do the same thing. Hey, come to Jesus. People are like, shut up! I mean, this guy was so anointed, but hear this, hear this. This guy would lay hands on people. People would be healed. Blind eyes would be opened. This is in the early days of Calvary. We used to really be charismatic. But then guess what? Here's the sad part. Before he was a Christian, he had struggled with homosexuality. The ministry got so consuming for him that he didn't really work on his, you know, his marriage was struggling, and then all of a sudden he went back to homosexuality. He died of AIDS. And yet he was used by God to start two major movements to really help. So do you see? I'm not saying be gay to have gifts. Okay? But I'm saying is that God, and I think, you know what I think that is? Can I just tell you this? Because when you're like that, you realize you need the grace of God. Sometimes we go, I'm perfect. Of course God would use me. Look at me. Besides his belly, I am perfect. Right? And we think that. And sometimes God goes, what? He opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. And I think because they're so broken in their sin that they know, God, only you can do this in me. You know? So I guess I'm saying sin big. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. I want to make sure you're awake. No, I'm saying is just keep humble and know that even though you don't sin as bad as so-and-so, you're still a sinner in God's eyes. Remember what Jesus said? I didn't come to heal those who are well or think they're well, really. But I came to heal those who are sick, who know I'm a sinner. I need Savior. I need the grace of God. Amen? Does that make sense to you? I hope I didn't freak you out too much. Some of you are like, sin? What kind of church is this? Right? But anyway, where am I? In addition to God's amazing, when someone has a gift of healing or word of knowledge, it's a tendency to assume that he or she must be very holy. But the gifts of the Spirit, however, are not dependent upon attaining a certain level of spirituality. As it says in Romans 11:29, it says the gifts and callings are without repentance. They're not irrevocable. Once God gives you a gift, he doesn't take it back because you're naughty. Okay? You can still have that gift. And so that shows us, and hear that. Realize it's not a gift because you prayed enough. You need to pray to realize what it is, but God gives it liberally. He gives it. Just like he gives you his grace and forgiveness, he gives you spiritual gifts. So do you see that? Does that free you? That we should just move into gifts. We should say, okay, God, but hear this. A lot of us don't even ask what our gift. If I asked you, every one of you, to raise your hand, what's your spiritual gift? A lot of you, salvation? I don't know. But how many of you need to pray and ask God, what is my gift? What is my gift to the body of Christ? What do I bring? Amen?
Amen.
And so that's that. But they're simply a matter of, the gifts are simply a matter of us bringing, being recipients of grace. This means ministry and spiritual gifts are not based upon what we're doing at all, but solely upon what God wants to do in us and through us by his grace. And I always like this. I always like to say this, that I'm a testimony of God's grace. When I first got saved, you know, I've cleaned up a little bit, but when I first got saved, a hair to the middle of my back, I looked bad. And people used to say, if God can save Craig, he can definitely save me. And how many know that's pretty neat? Okay? That's pretty cool. Because God can save anyone, right? Who would ever think God could save the Apostle Paul, who was killing Christians? But he did, and God can save. So you see that person, and as I said a couple weeks ago, the person who fights the most is probably the closest to the Lord. Remember, the opposite of love is not hate, it's apathy. When someone goes, I don't care. Hey, that's good for you. Whatever, dude. But when someone gets all worked up, Jesus, it's probably because Jesus has been working on them. And they're a little mad. And you should go, ooh, I think I got one. Right? It's kind of like a nibble on a fish. Ooh, ooh, right? You should be excited. They're nibbling. You know, they might be slapping it, but they're God's moving. So, verse 8. Who will also confirm you to the end that you may be blameless. I like that. Don't you love it? When we stand before God, those of us who are in Christ, when we stand before God, when Peter, whoever, we always say Peter, I don't know why, but we always say Peter, right, the keys of the kingdom, and Peter says, hey, what are the charges that we have on this guy? How many know there's a lot of charges against me? But how many know Jesus is going to stand up and say, blameless, covered by my blood? How many know that's good? Covered, washed by my blood. They're guilt-free, because not sinless, but they're guilt-free because I've covered their blood. I've paid the price for them. Amen. So he says, whom also confirm you to the end that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God, Paul's saying, God has been so good to you, Corinthians. He's been so good to you, Corinthian Christians. He'll see you through. Why? Well, let's read verse 9 to see why. God is faithful by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And notice this real quick. Notice how much he says, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jesus Christ, our Lord. How many know most American Christians have made Jesus Savior? Amen? 80% of America says that Jesus is their Savior. But how many know Jesus wants to not just be your Savior, he wants to also be your Lord. And how many know Savior's easy. Lordship, a little harder. Can we admit? Yeah. Tithing? No. Right? Hard. Lordship. I love what Spurgeon said. That's the last thing usually God gets from people is their money. Right? It's hard for us to give every area. But how many know Jesus is not just our Savior, but he also needs to be, we're moving into lordship, where he has lordship over every area of our life. Amen? Amen? And that's when the world will see the change and go, my goodness, God has not just saved you, but he's redeemed you. He's changed you. He's made you like his Son. That's cool. That's what I want to be like. So here it is. We're going to make it, Paul's saying. Why? Not because of anything we ourselves have done, but because God is faithful. That's why the psalmist says in Psalm 73, verse 23, he says that we are held by his right hand. How many like that? God's holding us by his right hand. Hear this. When I cross the street with my little girl, Trinity, and if you know Trinity, she's just the cutest little thing ever. There she is. Wave, Trin, if you ever see. That is a baby. And she's got a hand that's like teeny. And so I'll hold it and with my Goliath hand, and I hold it, and I'll say, Trin, hold my hand. And she's like, you know, kind of, you know, fast and quick, so you have to hold her tight. But if, say, we were crossing a busy street, and all of a sudden her hand, she trips. And even though I said for her to hold my hand, how many know really I'm holding her hand? And there's been many times where I've dragged my kids across the, you know, I mean, just, you know, I mean, no, not me. But you know what I mean? I'm holding their hand more than they're holding mine. Amen? And sometimes I'd even like walk for them. I just kind of make them bounce on their feet, you know, right? But how do you know God's doing that with you and I? Amen? He's holding you. He's holding you. And even though you and I are like dragging our feet and stumbling and falling and slipping all over the place like we're on ice skates or roller skates, he's holding you. Amen. Now, I believe we're supposed to partner with him, right? We're not supposed to be dragging our feet into the kingdom, but we, though, like I said, sincerely, we're going to stumble at times. Amen. Amen. But know he's holding you with his righteous right hand. I like what Philippians 1:6 says. He who has begun a good work in you will complete it on the day of Christ Jesus. How many like that? He, not well, it's up to me to complete the... No, he who's begun a good work will complete it. And I want to tell you this. I was talking with someone this week that had been a Christian for a long time but was struggling with sin. And they finally realized, you know what? They realized, you know, I'm not sure if I was really saved. Because what does the Bible say? If you're really saved, then what? A good tree produces good fruit, amen? And how many people you know say, I'm saved, but they're producing bad fruit? But how do you know that God's working your life? Because he's not going to let you stay in bad fruit. Now, if someone can keep being in bad fruit for 30 years and say, I'm a Christian, you need to question, did they really? Maybe they loved fire insurance, saying, oh, I want to be saved, but they haven't made Jesus Lord. And I'm going to tell you this. I'm not a scholar. Some of you go, amen. But I believe it's Savior and Lord. And when I knew I was saved is when I gave lordship to Jesus. When I finally said, you know what, Lord, I love the Savior part. I always loved it. I loved it for years. But it was when I finally said, okay, God, you're worthy of my life. That's when Romans says his spirit bears witness with our spirit that we're a child of God. That's when I knew that I was saved. Because how did I know? Because I gave the Lord my life. He moved so powerfully in my life. He showed me such a merited, undeserved favor that I said, you know what, Lord, I can't pay it back, but all I can do is give you my life. How many can bear witness with that? Amen? You remember that? And that's how you know. Not because you prayed some little prayer that didn't change your life, but you know because God is not letting you be the way you want to be. Amen? He's putting a new nature in you. How many know? When you were a pig, you loved mud, sin. But when you became a lamb, you're like, oh, sex, sin, right? Yucky, right? You don't like mud. You don't like sin anymore. Not that you never fail, but you don't walk in it because you don't like it, because God's put a new nature in you, a new nature. Amen? So too, even to these Corinthian Christians who are entangled in a whole lot of problems and a whole lot of sin, Paul says, guys, you're going to make it. Why? Because God is faithful. God is faithful. Hear that. Grace, unmerited, undeserved, unearned favor. Philippians 1:6 again. It's God who works in you to will and to do. The Corinthians, hear this. As I said earlier, were waiting for Christ to return. They were waiting for the Lord's return. But hear this, and this is kind of what I see a lot of the American church. They were not living in the light of his coming. Did you hear that? The Corinthians were waiting for Christ's return, but they were not living in the light or not ready for the light. How many know light exposes stuff? If I'm in darkness, I can say, man, look at how good this shirt is. But if all of a sudden bright lights get on, I can go, oh my goodness, there's a stain here. Have you ever done that? I'm a big boy. When I eat stuff, like there's a ridge that falls, okay? And sometimes I'll just go home, I'll be fine, and all of a sudden I look, and I'm like, oh my goodness, I've been walking around with mustard on my shirt all day, right? But that's what the light does. It exposes stuff. But hear this, guys. We're going to stand before the light of God, before Jesus, who is the light of the world. We're going to stand before him, and all of our life is going to be revealed. And I don't want to have willful stains in my life. Now hear this, here's the balance, and we have a hard time with balance, but here it is. He's imputed his righteousness to us, justified us, just as we never sinned. But here's what he says, right? Clothed, walk it out. He says he's coming back for a church with what? Without spot or wrinkle. Remember that? Spot is stained from without, from the world, being part of the world, and spot is stained within, meaning bitterness, unforgiveness, pornography, sins that's inside that only you and God see. But how do we know God's coming back for a church that's holy? He says, without holiness, no one shall see the Lord. I don't know about you, I want to see the Lord, amen? I don't know how you go to heaven without seeing the Lord. And we need to be committed to holiness. I love 1 John 3:3. You hear it said here a lot. But it says, he who has this hope, what's the hope? Of the Lord's return. He who has this hope will keep themselves pure just as he is pure. Because you know what? You know he could come back at any time. And I don't know about you, I want to be the Lord come back while I'm preaching. Amen? I don't want to be watching some stupid movie or bad movie. I don't want to be doing something on the internet I shouldn't be doing. I want to be ready, found doing something that like, hey, yes! And you go, I don't know about that. I see you're legalistic, Craig. Here it is. Here's a verse for you to confirm what I'm saying. 1 John 2:28. Now little children, abide in him, abide in Jesus. So that when he appears, we may have confidence and not shrink away from him in shame at his coming. If you're walking in willful sin and you're taking sin lightly, how many know? Did you hear what the word says? You don't, and not shrink away from him in shame at his coming. That you could just be like, oh, Lord, I don't know about you. I don't want to face God that way. I want to face him reverently, but I want to face him in shame, going, oh, no. I want to say, like Paul, to live is Christ, to die is gain. I fought the good fight. I'm ready. Now lays up for me a crown of righteousness. I'm ready to stand before God. I don't want to be, oh no, I should have. Oh, I didn't know it was today. And I want to tell you, people say this. I mean, we're living in the last days. You know why? Because I hear from Christians say, well, yeah, but you know, the Lord, you know, people have been saying he could come back anytime, but it's been hundreds of years. How many know that's when the Lord says he's going to come? When everyone's like, meh, 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 meh. Right? He's going to come like a thief in the night, right? Thief doesn't go, hey, Ted, I'm coming over about 3:45. Is that good for you? No, they come when you least expect it. And Jesus is not a thief, but he comes when you are getting cynical, saying, it's just, you know, I was saying the Talking Heads thing, it's the same as it ever was. We think it's just the same. Nobody knows that song. Does anyone know that song? The same as it ever was. We think that it's just like, it's just going to keep on going. How do you know? Can any old people out there like me say, it's gotten really weird in the last 5 to 10 years? You got to be smoking some serious crack to not think, oh, it's the same. It is not the same. I know 80-year-old pastors go, it's not the same. I've been in ministry 50 years. It is not the same. This is weird. And how many know, depending on the election, it could get even weirder, right? Either way, it could maybe, I was telling someone, it could get weird either way, right? We don't know what's going to happen. Woo, right? I mean, but hear this. The weirder it gets, the more Jesus is coming back sooner, right? So, you know, people at Dyke Calvary, they say, you know, the thing with Calvary, we get excited when it gets bad. It's the Lord's coming, right? We shouldn't try to just let go of the wheel and let it crash. But how many know we should do our best? But how many know as it gets crazier, that's the inference that God, that shows us that the Lord's coming back. Because I was saying to someone, do you realize it's got to get to a place where it gets so bad the Lord takes us out because why? We're no longer salt and light. The world has basically shut the church down. Do you understand that? Do you see that happening? Do you notice that? Christianity, don't say a word. Don't talk, right? You know, don't talk. Don't say a word. But Muslims, they get to pray four times a day at work. To have a break, to pray, to Mecca. Do you see Christians get, can I say, I like four times a day pray. They'd say, whatever, dude. That's the world we live in. And we can either just get angry about it, but we can also, like we said a couple weeks ago, look up for redemption draws near. Wow, the Lord's coming back. And how we know? You go, yeah, whatever, but have that hope. You know why? Even if the Lord doesn't come back in my day, it'll keep me pure because it keeps me on my toes ready for the Lord. Amen? So it's good to have that expectation because if Paul believed he could come back in his day, he definitely can come back in our day. Amen? Though the Corinthians were sinful on earth, God would be able to present them as blameless in heaven because of his amazing grace, his unmerited, undeserved favor. But we hear this. This is my balance. And hear this. How many know we've gone, when Martin Luther came on the scene, what was the struggle back in the 1500s, 1500s, was works, legalism, right? Works. You got to work your way to heaven. But now, and I love, let me preface this. So hear that. In the 1500s or 1450, I think, we were works, right? Catholicism. I was a Catholic. I can say it's works. A.W. Tozer says we tend to go one extreme or the other. So works was what Martin Luther, the great reformer, brought. But now, I believe America, we're over here now. And we're at what? Grace. Grace, grace, grace. I can do whatever I want because of grace. But how many know we need to be here in the balance? Not works, not grace, 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 that sin might abound, that we keep sinning, but it should be a balance. It should be a balance. We should not use this passage to excuse our willful sin. Rather, it should be seen as an encouragement that God is always faithful, even though we may fail him at times. But as I've said many times before, that when we truly understand God's amazing grace that saved a wretch like you and I, amen? That we, that saved a wretch like you and I, that we may, it should change the way you and I live. Grace should change us. I remember when I got saved out of being a drug dealer, a womanizer, a bad guy. And I remember walking around and all I could say was, man, God loves me. And it wasn't like, God loves me. It was, God loves me. I didn't even love myself. I hated me. I almost killed me. But God saved me. And if God could save me, he could save anyone. And I was just like, God saved me. And people would be like, well, I'd say, he loves me. And they go, he loves me too. And I go, no, but I don't deserve his love. And how many know all of us should have a heart like that? I don't deserve his love. And if you think you do, then you got problems. Because the issue should be, he saved a wretch like me. And it shouldn't be a cute song. It should be real. I don't know why he would want to save me, but I'm so thankful he did. Amen? Amen. Here's what Paul said at the end of Corinthians about grace. 1 Corinthians 15:10. He said, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace towards me was not in vain. That means, another version says, it didn't have no effect. If you've really been saved by grace, it will have a great effect on your life. Because you'll realize, Why did you save me? You won't go, I am chosen, of course. You would say, why did he save me? That's so cool, he saved me. Hear this. Remember what Paul said about himself? I'm the chief of sinners. Chief. And people believe because he killed the first martyr, he killed the first Christian martyr, and he's saying, I'm the chief of sinners. But hear this. Here's what grace did to Paul. You don't hear this preached much, but I labor more abundantly than they all. The New Living says this, for I have worked harder than any other apostle. Now he catches himself because he doesn't want to get too boasting in himself. He says this, yet not I, but the grace of God which was within me. Do you hear that, guys? True grace works. True grace works. It doesn't work to be saved. It works because it is saved and is favored and is loved. Amen? And once you go, oh my goodness, he saved me, he loved me. Then you're going to go, I don't know what to do, but all I can do is give, I can't pay it back, but all I can do is give him my life. And you know what I tell you? I know you guys say I talk a lot about myself, but I'll tell you this. I'd like to see more conversions like my conversion. You don't see people get accept Jesus and whew, totally change very much anymore. I mean, you see it in Iran, you see it in China, but not so much here, because I think we've made it so just sloppy agape. We've made grace like, of course God would save me. Of course God loves me. Why wouldn't he love me? Because you ask the average person, what do they say? I'm a good person. And I always tell you guys this. I love it. It was Way of the Master said this. If you believe you're a good person, then you don't know Jesus. Because why? Jesus didn't come to save good people. He came to save sinners. And you have to know you're a sinner before you appreciate the grace of God. Amen? So what's the answer? As I said, true grace works. Now hear me, again, we don't work for grace, but we work from grace. We work because God has given us unmerited, undeserved favor that you and I, as I said, deeply don't deserve. And because Jesus has given us something that we can never repay, the least we can do is give him our life. I want to end with this scripture. 1 Corinthians 6:20 says this, for God bought you with a high price. What was that high price? His precious blood of his son. That's what covered your sin and mine. The high price was his son dying on a cross and his blood being shed to cover your sins. So here's what he says at the end of it. So you must honor God with your body. Here's the payment, guys. You can't pay it, but here's what God asks through Paul. Give him your life. Honor him with your body. Romans 12:1. You're a living sacrifice. Let your life be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto him. Give your life to God. Amen? And when the world sees you do that, they're going to go, what's going on here? But if you say, oh, you know, Christians aren't perfect, just forgiven, they're like, whatever. But when they see you saved, say you're saved, but they see a transformed life and they see your life changing and giving your life yielded to God, then they go, wow, I want to see that. I want some of that. Does anyone remember that? It's an old Carmen song. Is anyone, any old Carmenites? Remember, I want some of that. Okay, one person. All right, I'm old. Anyway, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to say you're old. I'm just saying I'm old. Okay. I make friends wherever I go. I want to give you an opportunity. We're going to take communion in a moment. But what I'd like you to do, can we get the lights? If you're here today, and you would say, Pastor Craig, I'm not sure that if I was to die that I would spend eternity with God. I want to give you that opportunity to give your life to Christ, to say, you know what, I surrender my life to Christ. And maybe you're here, and there's probably a bigger group of this, but if you're here today and you'd say, Pastor Craig, I know Christ, but I haven't really made Jesus the Lord of my life. I haven't really been obeying him. I've been walking in willful sin and been doing my own thing. I've been the prodigal son doing my own thing. And you feel the Holy Spirit of God right now calling you to give your life to him, to honor him with your life. Then I'd like to ask right now that every head would bow and every eye be closed out of honor and respect for the Lord. But what I'd like to ask you to do is, it says in Romans 10:9, that it says, if we confess the Lord Jesus with our mouth and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we shall be saved. And so what I want is everyone here, if you're doing great with the Lord, if you say, I don't fit in any one of those categories, then pray right now that the Holy Spirit would draw those that need to receive Christ. And pray that the Holy Spirit would draw those who need to recommit their life to say, you know what, I'm making Jesus not just my Savior, but my Lord, to where I obey him. I give him my life. I honor him with my body. And what I'd like to ask her right now, that no one feels left like they're the only ones praying, pray this prayer with me, everyone, if you would. And how many know we can't confess the Lord Jesus too much, amen? We can't surrender, we can't believe too much. And so just pray this prayer with me, if you would. Pray it out loud. Lord Jesus, I confess to you I'm a sinner. Please forgive me my sin. Thank you for receiving me for the first time, or thank you as I recommit my life to you afresh. I confess the Lord Jesus. I believe in my heart that you raised him from the dead. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and empower me to live for you all the days of my life. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer in a minute, fill out the card if you would. It's in the front of your seat. Or tell someone today. Make sure you let someone know. But now you're ready to receive communion. I also, as the ushers are passing out the elements, the bread and the juice, just hold it in your hand, and then we will take communion together as a church. But what I'd like to ask you too is that just take this time. If there's some issues in your life, some sin that you haven't dealt with, just quietly confess that to the Lord and get right. Because the Bible talks in 1 Corinthians 11 that we need to rightly discern. We need to judge ourselves rightly so we will not be judged. It says, many are you weak and sick and even sleep, which means death, because you take the body of Christ lightly. You don't discern the body of Christ. And how many know we need to take this as a holy moment? This is where God's presence is. And so we need to do that. So just take this time to just get right with God, and then we'll receive communion together as a church.